Hello, everyone, and welcome to another segment of Appetizers for Success. My name is John Arnold, and I'm an executive coach.
Hello, and welcome again to our mini-series, Appetizers for Success, where we interview exquisite leaders like the one we're interviewing today. My name is Marilena Beuses, based in Palm Beach, Florida. And today, John, do you want to introduce us to our wonderful speaker today?
Yeah, we're excited to have Ralph Campbell. First and foremost, I'd like to introduce him as a good friend. I feel that the friendship piece is most important. And every time I have the opportunity to spend time with Ralph, I learn so much. So I'm going to take executive privilege here and read a little bit about Ralph. Ralph is the president of Learning Optimize. Ralph has spent the last 24 years focused on ontological leadership, performance-based coaching, diversity awareness, and youth mentoring to thousands of people in the United States. Prior to his current role, Ralph spent 23 years in the business arena where he was the CEO of one of the largest insurance agencies in South Florida, as well as co-founding two separate leadership training and development companies, Summit Education and Universal Dynamics. What's equally important about Ralph and who he is and what's important to Ralph in his life, he spent the last number of decades chairing various community boards, some of which have included United Way of Broward County, Nova Southeastern University Ambassador, Broward Partnership for the Homeless, Boys and Girls Club of Broward County, Leadership Broward, Women in Distress, and countless other organizations. Ralph truly believes a great deal can be told about a person by their growth and incremental mindset. And Ralph, welcome to Appetizers for Success. Thank you for joining us today.
John and Marilena, thank you for having me.
Ralph, please take a few minutes to talk a little bit about the ontological leadership and what that means for you, and then maybe we'll migrate into success mindsets as part of your curricula.
Yeah, thanks, John. Ontological leadership is really the study of ways of being, right? So it deals with who we're being. And it's an area of transformation. So I'm a transformative coach, and transformative coaches, we focus on who we're being and ways of being for our clients.
Excellent. Can you talk a little bit about the success mindset work that you do?
Yeah, success mindsets is one of my signature frameworks. And we think about leadership frameworks. There's thousands and thousands of leadership frameworks, right? Put your hand in a jar and pick out a framework. And they're all very, very important. I believe fundamentally, success mindsets is one of the most important leadership frameworks because it deals with the lenses that you and I wear. Both of you two are wearing glasses. And so I look at mindsets as eyeglasses. And mindsets are the mental lenses that we use to view the world. And these eyeglasses, they dictate the information our minds absorb. And then this information is what ultimately fuels how we think, learn, and behave. And so I support people understanding, one, what are mindsets, how they work, and why they are important to professional and personal development.
Thank you. You know, Marilena, one of the concepts that Ralph talks about is leader humility. And I think both you and I have experienced that over the last 25 years. In the work we've done with leaders worldwide, I wondered if you would talk a little bit about your experience with leader humility, and we can transition to Ralph.
Well, for me, it's fundamental. You know, what ego gets in the way, you know, everything is not the true us speaking. So, Ralph, can you tell us, you know, in your own experience as you work with leaders, you know, how the servant leadership or the leadership humility you know, has worked for you as you have coached, you know, thousands of people? Especially, I'm interested in knowing about the youth and how that servant leadership or that humble leadership shows up.
Yeah, first I'll start off with an operational definition of when I talk about leadership humility, because I'm sure there's a lot of definitions. And so leadership humility to me is a tendency to display and feel a deep regard for another person's dignity. And so when I talk about dignity, I'm talking about another person's inherent value and worth. And so, especially with our young people, oftentimes as we grow up in this very challenging world, especially in the era of, or the year of the pandemic, I call 2020 the year of the pandemic. You know, our young people don't always feel that they're being treated with dignity. And so when a young person feels that they're not valuable or worthy, that's when they start adapting to other vices, which could be drugs, depression, anxiety, disconnecting, loneliness is a big one. But what the data tells us is that when young people feel that their dignity is being honored, right? It's being honored, you start to see the mental health numbers really increase. Like they're stronger in their mental health. You start to see less depression, less anxiety, better schoolwork, better relationships. And so that's a really, really big framework that I support young people and adults working through and understanding.
You know, Ralph, over the last probably 10 or 15 years, there's been a lot more conversation in the field of neuroscience, right? I mean, it's entered into the coaching space and leadership space pretty big time, I might say. Can you talk a little bit about the predictive brain and how you utilize that in your either coaching work or leadership work?
Great question, John. Thank you for asking. Yeah, I'm happy. I'm happy that finally we have disciplines that speak to each other. For so long, we have various disciplines that are operate in silos and each are very important. But now what the data tells us is that they're integrated, they're interconnected. And so the predictive brain, the premise of the predictive brain says that the brain predicts, it doesn't react. And so if you think about cause, effect, stimuli, response, mm-hmm. I probably sound crazy speaking to you now because we've been taught, we've been trained in largely the area of psychology, cause, effect. And so, yeah, if you're looking through the lens of psychology, absolutely. I yell at you, John, and you yell back at me, right? I do something and you react to it. And so that is natural looking through the lens of psychology. But with neuroscience, when we're talking about these 86 billion neurons in our brains, that is not the lens. And through the lens of the predictive brain, what the theory is telling us is that human beings, we actually are guessing. We're making predictions. We're not really reacting. And so when you look at it from neuroscience, what we're doing is we're making guesses based on our past experiences. And so we bring our past experiences into the future and we're guessing. And that's a survival technique. If you go back hundreds of thousands of years ago, that was useful to human beings. Of course, today, it's not necessarily useful, although it makes us very, very efficient to make predictions.
Thanks for that, Ralph. Now, Marilena, you and I have been trained to ask open-ended, deep questions with our coaching clients, right? That's, you know, we are not trained to give advice to our clients. We are trained to coach our clients and ask those open-ended, deep questions. Ralph, you have a philosophy. Maybe that's not even that doesn't do justice to it. But you talk about the art of asking beautiful questions. What is the art of asking beautiful questions?
Yeah, John, I'm trained like you, right? Open-ended questions. We don't give advice. I read a lot of books by Michael Bungay Stanier, and he talks about the advice trap of not giving advices and how to ask questions. And so I made that up, like beautiful questions. Like what's up, you know, what do you mean? How could a question be beautiful? It's just a question. So that's a way to stimulate my clients, right? And to appreciate them that I'm going to be asking a beautiful question. And the art of asking beautiful questions is really concentrating, being present and listening to what's actually being said. And I don't mean listening with a response or from the predictive brain, because oftentimes coaches listen from a prediction, like therapy. You say this, or this is the condition, this is the treatment. Doctors predict all the time. Right. And as we know, they're wrong a lot of times, right? And so with coaches, we predict a lot of times. And when we're not really listening, we often start giving advice, which is not coaching. That's something else that we'll talk about a little later in part, largely therapy. But the art of asking beautiful questions is to be present with what your client is asking of themselves. I didn't say what I'm asking of the client. What the client is ultimately asking of themselves. And that comes out of asking questions based on what it is that's limiting them. So these limiting beliefs, these limiting assumptions, and really just being present. Of course, there's a ton of general questions we can ask to open up a possibility, to open up sharing. But ultimately, it comes with really being present and listening and focusing on exactly what is going on with the client.
Ralph, I have to ask, it's my own curiosity. I know you're an avid or voracious reader. About how many books a year do you read?
Yeah. You know, I took on a project about 4 years ago because I believe that we all need to be up to something big in our lives all the time. And for me, it's learning and growing. We can grow a lot of different ways, as you know, John. It's not just through experiential learning, not just through practicing, not just through watching videos, not just through having mentors and coaches. I like to learn through reading. And so I read 50 books a year. And it's a project that I'm committed to taking on for the rest of my life. So I'm 51. I'm telling you, I'm old now, John and Marilena. And I'm 51 years old. And so I read 50 books a year as a way to keep myself grounded and to remind myself that I'm always the student.
Wow. That's amazing.
That's awesome. That's I can keep up with, you know, one book per month. Ralph. And it shows, in your vocabulary and, you know, how studious you have been of different disciplines. I'm just wondering, when you're talking to leaders and knowing that not all leaders learn the same way, what has been most effective for you when in your work with leaders? You know, what kind of approach do you use the most? And again, I want to refer to young leaders, maybe because John and I in this space have been talking about, you know, the corporate leaders, but I'm interested of, you know, besides, you know, listening intensively and being very present for them, what has worked for you?
Well, the first thing I've noticed with young leaders that has been beneficial to me and to them is to support them creating a compelling why. What's your vision for yourself, for your life? What's your purpose? Some people call it your cause. I call it, to me, a compelling why. And that's where I start, John and Marilena. Before I do anything else, needs assessment, big goals, obstacles, it's really, what is your why? What's your reason? You know, what gets you out of bed? And if I can start there, usually a whole new world opens up because now they get to create this invented future based on what matters most to them.
Thanks, Ralph. Ralph, in the short time we have remaining, can you talk a little bit about your 100 Heroes project?
Yeah, that's an exciting project. I took it on 4 years ago, 5 years ago, when I was 46 years old. And I said, man, I want to write a book one day and do something really, really special. And so I decided to interview 100 people that I consider heroes in the world. And I wanted to interview people that really didn't make the podcast. Maybe they weren't published authors. You didn't see them on social media, but they were people like a Gandhi that you didn't always see in real time, but left a huge legacy. And so I begin my journey of interviewing 100 people that I consider heroes. And my definition of heroes are any man or woman who dares to see or meet the call of the possibility of creating something bigger than themselves. So that means anybody can be a hero. And so I didn't have to be selective. And I've been on that journey. I didn't hit the mark, John. As you know, in coaching, we set goals and it's not so much about the goal, but about the process, about who we got to be, what worked, what didn't work, and then make a future declaration. So I'm close to 75 now.
Wow.
So stay tuned. But that's my project. And I'm excited. I've learned so much and met so many amazing people from all over the world.
Well, Ralph, when you hit that 100 mark, we're going to have to bring you back and you're going to have to tell us about that journey.
Absolutely.
My pleasure.
Well, Ralph, Marilena and I both appreciate you joining us today. Thank you so much for your words of wisdom, your inspiration. You know, you inspire so many people, thousands of people. And the work you're doing with future leaders is just incredible. And thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, thank you, John and Marilena, for having me and being such generous hosts. And Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you as well.
Happy New Year to you too.